This is a Culture Inject production.
All right, welcome back to Part of Us. Follow us on YouTube, Instagram, and Facebook at En Vogue Craze, and on Twitter at Part of Us Fancast. Comments or questions, let us hear it. Email them to us at partofusevf@gmail.com. Please review and rate our podcast. Now, let's get into the episode.
Okay, we're getting into what's new, what's trending. We're catching up, and it looks like we're actually trending. We had our most popular episode this season because of a letter written by our guest. We have a guest host on this episode, Mr. DT.
Hello.
Hello, DT.
Hey, folks. How y'all doing? Glad to be here. Thanks for inviting me.
Thank you for being on.
Yes.
So before we really get into the situation at hand, tell us a little bit about yourself. Anything that you feel comfortable with, and especially how that, you know, pertains to En Vogue. Like, what's your history with En Vogue? When were you introduced to them? Have you ever worked with them? You know, what's going on?
Well, name is DT, and I'm a longtime En Vogue fan, obviously a little bit leaning toward the earlier years. My introduction to En Vogue was when they first came out, and that's the train I rode. So I was a diehard En Vogue fan, started at the beginning with the Born to Sing album, and I was watched everything, listened to everything, all the way up until about the time Masterpiece came out, and I was just did not, everything changed for me, all of which we've discussed. So I will concede that my post-Masterpiece album knowledge of En Vogue is limited because I was so into the original four. So I will take all the hits that come with that. But I feel like I'm pretty well versed on, you know, En Vogue up to that point. And I've kept track of the politics and the things that have happened with the ladies, you know, through social media and all these other ways you can keep abreast of things. And so I think I've tried to keep informed with the girls and the ladies since then. Now, as far as my personal background, yes, I do have some, I'd say, limited expertise or experience in the entertainment field. I'm an attorney by profession. I moved to California in 1999. I'm from Michigan. I actually started working at an entertainment litigation firm when I was a young up-and-coming associate, and I pretty much worked for a law firm that defended a lot of the big labels. I won't mention any of their names, but so I was literally reviewing bad contracts that went south where artists were suing to get their rights, more money, royalties, credit for songs, publishing, et cetera, you name it. So I was on the label side defending. So that was really my lens on how record deals go south and how record deals can be saved. And so that's kind of how I've always looked at En Vogue and a lot of these other groups, especially in Black music, that just couldn't hold it together because of this crazy legal world that they have to navigate. And so anyway, but that was the first few years of my practice. By the mid-2000s, I was what you would call a starving entertainment lawyer. Just like you can have a starving artist, you can have a starving entertainment lawyer, because I just moved to another firm where we did more traditional litigation, and that's where I've been ever since. So I still do a little bit of work for friends who want, you know, hey, tell me this record deal. How does it look? What should I negotiate? You know, I do a little bit on the side, but not an active entertainment practice now. So that's a little bit about me. I live in Los Angeles, and I think that's about it.
Okay. And I mean, well, that just goes to show the caliber of our listeners. We have, you know, the cream of the crop, the best of the best listening to Part of Us En Vogue Fancast. So we're very honored. Now, the letter you wrote, like I said, of course, you know, I only see the YouTube.
It was spicy.
I mean, it was. And it was so spicy that, like, our viewership kind of jumped because I don't think we had hit over 400 views this season, and really, like, it caught up to, and, like, I just look at the YouTube numbers, which was, I was trying to say, I don't look at Amazon and all the other platforms that we're on, so I don't know how we're doing there, but that, we saw the increase, and so I saw also, I looked, I try not to look too much, because I don't want to ever make it seem like I'm influencing the views, since I'm a part of the podcast, so I don't want to just keep clicking back and forth, but I look like, I think, after we hit 100, then 200, then about 400, just to see what the comments were. And so obviously you saw some of the responses. What did you think of the response to your letter? And is there anything that you wanted to maybe rebut as far as what we had to say, for most likely me, in regards to your letter?
You know, first of all, I should qualify. My letter was so wordy. I'm just in awe how you all were able to sift through it and make it digestible and organized to present, because I know that letter was all over the place. So whoever that was, just brilliant there, that alone, and how you guys processed it and organized it. I think that's what made it a good show, not my ranting and my letter itself. But anyway, I thought that the comments and the feedback were just like they were before the episode, just maybe not as loud or not as thorough. So I'll respond to 2 points so we don't, you know, get buried into it again. Like, I know we can easily dive in. But the first issue was, there seemed to be a lot of comments that were put off that I was quote unquote dissing Rona. And I can see that perspective. I certainly think Rona is a wonderful talent. I think Rona is an awesome singer. I've watched a lot of her on YouTube individually. I followed her career individually, but my position kind of stands that she's not the original four. And what I mean by a fill-in, to me, a fill-in is a person that steps into a group and they pretty much replace the already well-oiled machine person or group that's there. Now, a new group member is someone that takes the group in my opinion, to equal or higher heights. So for me, Rona has been a wonderful person that allows the En Vogue train to continue on. 80% of their music, from what I've heard, I've never been to a show recently of En Vogue, 80% of their music is the hits, and then they'll throw in a Rona song, they'll throw in a Rona written song, and they'll give Rona some shine. But that show is making money off of the albums, the songs off the first two albums, maybe going up to a little bit into Masterpiece, and then whatever current hit they have. So for me, just like Cindy Bird's song to me was a fill-in for the Supremes, just like to me, the singer who came into Rufus when Shaka left and went solo for an album or a spot date or a tour, that's a fill-in. I also consider the reality that Rona is not a equity member of the group. So equity, a lot of folks were saying, you know, she's a part of the group now. She deserves more than the original because she's put in more time. That's true. You know, some people own a house that they lived in for a year and then they rented it out for 30 years to one person. That person that's rented it out for 30 years doesn't own the home. That's okay. The way I look at En Vogue in a large sense. That person is keeping the house.
That's a good analogy.
they may be doing some great, wonderful improvements to the home. They may have made that home theirs. But the title on that deed is not the renter's property. So that's my whole take.
You got to go already.
But I mean, that applies to pretty much everybody with Cindy and Terry then, and that applies to the original members why they were there as well. Like, I previously have stated, like, with, like, say, a band like Guns N' Roses, where you had everyone who started with Appetite for Destruction, so that's Slash, Axl, the drummer, Izzy Stradlin, Duff McKagan, they all started equally, but Axl, he was the lead singer. He was the main writer. So they split up the royalties based on how much was written. So the drummer got the least, even though he was an original. So the whole kind of thing about equity, how do you feel when you consider that none of the girls, when they were at their peak, they didn't own the name. They didn't own really anything. They weren't the main songwriters. They weren't the main creatives behind the group. So how does that apply to them?
I think you make an excellent point. And En Vogue is a group owned initially by Tommy and Denny, and I guess you could say co-owned by the investors at the label that allowed them to have the production deal. The current owners of En Vogue, and I think it goes back, I'd have to check the records, but the current owners of En Vogue, if you go to check the U.S. Copyright and Patent Office, is Cindy and Terry. That's who's listed as the owners. En Vogue Enterprises, now I believe it's called En Vogue Partnership, with the listed agent and owner being Cindy and Terry, respectively. There's no Tommy and Denny. There's no other entities. Now, maybe there's some owners or people who are part of Cindy and Terry's respective companies, but they are listed as the two registered owner and agent of what the current company that owns the name En Vogue. So when that happened, you're right, it did. That's not how it was back in 1989. That's not how it was back in 1995. It probably isn't what it was in 2005. But they were the folks generating the income and taking the act on tour, meaning they had property. They had property and ownership of their touring. They did not own the name. So publishing, record sales, to this day, I don't know if En Vogue has, the current members of En Vogue have recouped those things. But they, as a touring act, they do own themselves. They can go on the road and tour and make money, which has been largely their income since the beginning, not record sales. And I think that's what Cindy and Terry have resolved. And maybe that was their feeling of not fighting from the beginning. Okay, we didn't make money off of recording. Let's throw in the towel, but let's make this bank and tour, take this sucker on the road, and that's how we will earn our living. And that's fine. But what exactly was the group's understanding about making money in 89, in 93, in 97? Did Max and Dawn just want to be an act, touring act, and struggle on the road and do that for 30 years? Or did they want to do what most artists do, which is start to own their worth, own their property? Because many artists do that. So I'll stop right there. But you make a good point, Matan, that none of the four owned the group initially. But I believe they all in their own ways tried to take ownership at various points of as much as the brand as they could.
To play devil's advocate, I will say that it is very telling that Rona does not have ownership of the group legally, and she's been a member of the group for 15 years. That is very telling, but it just goes to show that at the end of the day, Cindy and Terry do call the shots. So in that regard, I can understand why some people who are fans of the OG members of the original lineup can sort of say that Rona is not a real member, because, you know, She don't own the name, you know? So I can kind of understand that in regard. For me, me championing for Rona comes from those who discredit her contributions to the name continuing on, you know? One, I mean, could Cindy and Terry tour as a duo? Maybe, maybe not. However, there are a lot of things, and I do say this a lot on the show, there are a lot of things that En Vogue has done as a trio that should be commended in the current industry. And I feel like because she's a part of the group, that keeps the brand going. I don't know how the world will react to just having a duo of En Vogue on stage and there's not three-part harmony. You know, yeah. What is Terry going to do the 8-count while Cindy sings and then they switch around? This ain't Nina Sky, you know? it ain't that. So granted, I wouldn't be, I've said it on the show before, I wouldn't be opposed to Terry and Cindy doing a duo as En Vogue, but that means the sound would have to kind of take a pivot, which I think is okay. But there are just people who were just like, Rona is not you know, she's not a member. And I'm like, but she's been in the group. She did a Lifetime movie. They did Coming to America. They have a whole album out. You know, like she loves being a part. She loves En Vogue, even with the backlash. You know, even when they do interviews and they don't talk to her, you know, even when they do interviews and they only talk to Cindy and Terry about old news. And I'm like, talk to this girl because she's here in your face. You know, I feel like she's always being slighted. And for a woman of her caliber whose entire career is her being slighted, Dark Child, Mickey Mouse Club, like she's always getting the short end of the stick. And so now,
what are you talking about? She was slighted on the Mickey Mouse Club.
I just mean like
she didn't have the career that the Justins and the Britneys and the Christinas.
It didn't turn out the same way for her. So I feel like there's always like she's always getting the short end of the stick. And now that she's a part of an entity that is embracing her, because Cindy and Terry, they love her, you know. And then there's a portion of the fan base who love her as well. I just champion her because I feel like some of the backlash, some of the shade is not warranted, but I can understand in some regard why people are having a hard time digesting her membership.
I've said it 100 times. I think Rona is talented. I don't think anyone can ever say that Rona is not talented. Rona does not bring, you know, a great voice, and she seems to be very pleasant. But I'm going to say this. Every group needs a Kelly Rowland. Every group needs a Michelle Williams. Every group needs somebody that is just going to do their part and not cause waves. And for me, whether it was Rona or whether it was Jane Doe down the street in that spot, it wouldn't matter. Like, I don't think Rona hasn't done anything that has, like DT said, she hasn't furthered the group any more than where they already were at their peak. You know what I'm saying? So to me, yeah,
she's. And they haven't either, though.
That's the point.
In 2012, they didn't further the group either, or when they were together.
En Vogue has peaked. En Vogue is a nostalgia act. They're never going to have a radio hit. They're never going to be where they were. They're never going to be where, you know, beyond where they were at their prime. So to me, anyone can take that spot. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's like I've made this equation previously. Like, to me, it's like Johnny Gill in New Edition. When Johnny Gill came in and he took over for Bobby, like, they went to higher heights. They had,
So they don't have any of that. So to compare when En Vogue reunited in this decade or in the previous decade to the Cindy, Terry, and Rona killed them in that decade. I mean, they had a Lifetime movie. They closed two major reality shows on broadcast TV. Like, the originals weren't doing that when they were together from what, 2010 to 2012 or whenever. So to compare what they're able to do in that decade without a record deal, without having hit songs, they did better with Rona. So
absolutely not. Like, no.
Yes, they did. What did they do?
Absolutely not. Here's the part that you're not considering. At the end of the day, if with Rona, Cindy and Terry can do whatever they want. Rona doesn't have a say. She's someone that's just there, and she's going to collect the check. She does not make a decision. With the original four, even though, yeah, Cindy and Terry still own the name, but at the end of the day, with the original four, Maxine and Dawn were still not going to do certain things. So they couldn't move. Cindy and Terry couldn't move collectively without the other two. But since the other two are out of the picture, they can do whatever they want to do. You know what I'm saying?
That doesn't negate what I said, that when the original four got together, I guess whatever they didn't do, it still hindered them because they didn't do much. And like I said, when they got Rona on board, then we get music, we get a Lifetime movie, we get, you know, like they're closing out award shows. So they moved better with her than they did with them. So and I guess we can just might as well get into the discussion. Heirs to the Throne and how Maxine and Dawn move and how, you know, how they've been able to, you know, move themselves forward if they were. So let's get into the discussion then. How about that?
I would argue that Rona's been in the group long enough. I feel like her input is valued and she does have a say-so, possibly in creative directions. However, at the end of the day, if Cindy and Terry wanted to overrule anything she says, they are able to do that because they own the name. And that means they control her membership. So if they wanted to oust her out, she don't have no legal backing. So she would have to.
Oh yes, she would have to get gone. She could probably tell you that. But if you're from California and you signed a contract, I forget what it's called. It's not property rights, or maybe property rights, but they can't just throw her out if there's an expectation that the employment is going to continue. So she does have recourse. But that's not my, like, the discussion is Dawn and Maxine. And since you have half of the group on one side and half of the group on the other side, let's see how they're able to move the En Vogue legacy forward. Let's get into it.
But at the end of the day, they can't move anywhere because they don't own the name. So it's like, it's all a moot point. They don't have any legal
standards. Okay, so then all, going back into a circle, then all the way around, so they don't own the name, but you're still Dawn and Maxine. So you mean that means absolutely nothing? Being Maxine Jones and being Dawn Robinson means absolutely nothing?
Hold on. So, okay. So today's episode is called Dawn and Maxine Strike Back. It's called Dawn and Maxine Strike Back, and all this fire, we gonna push her forward to the discussion. So first, we're gonna start with Heirs to the Throne. In October 2012, Maxine and Dawn appeared on Access Hollywood to announce the formation of their new girl group, Heirs to the Throne. The duo launched a Twitter and a Facebook page for the group and even commissioned our producer, Matthew, shout out to him, to create a website for them. Speaking to Coco Cure magazine, the duo said the music they were interested in recording, this is a direct quote, "We're calling it urban rock. It's edgier. The harmonies are two-part. When you hear Maxine and I together, it's like, wow, that sounds like En Vogue a slight bit. The voices are still there, but it's edgier, it's more current. I would say more cutting edge. We're taking risks with our new music as well."
Heirs to the Throne performed at several venues with Shantae Usual as the group's third member. However, the group never officially started. Jones and Robinson parted ways after Robinson chose not to go through with the new group. Instead, Robinson went on to join the cast of the reality show R&B Divas LA, and Jones formed her own group called En Vogue to the Max. More on that later. So, what did you think of this short-lived group? Were you excited for this new team-up? Were any of you familiar with Shantae before this? And do you think they had the potential to be successful? And did anybody attend the live shows?
Okay, so I will say I did look up Shantae Usual. And she's a pretty girl. She's a very pretty girl. She has a nice voice. And then she does have a song called Phoenix that has kind of like a rocker edge to it, so I can understand how they would add her to that lineup if that was the direction they were going musically. But I don't think her voice matches to the caliber that En Vogue's original vocals gave. So it made sense for, I guess, this new iteration. But she's a pretty girl. She can sing. She's really, really pretty. She was giving us fashions in her little music video with 1,000 views. No shade. I think she's really cool. Okay. Well, when it goes to the Max, let's talk. I'll just go there. One, it's a horrible name. It's a horrible name. I feel like Latavia and Latoya tried to do that with Destiny's Child. But we're going to start a new girl group. I think it was called Angel or something.
This group was called Heirs to the Throne, which I think is a horrible name. But Heirs to the Throne was Dawn and Maxine.
That name was horrible, too. That name was horrible, too.
Because that's when Watch the Throne with Jay-Z and Kanye was out, and they thought there was going to be like Jay-Z and Kanye.
I just feel like leaving a group and starting a group immediately is not a good look, because everything you're doing is emotional. You're trying to, like, oh, look what we can do without you type of thing. And I feel like that's not a good foundation to stand on. Like, leave the group and really, like, figure out, okay, what do we want to do in this moment, but I feel like starting a group, like, and then going to Access Hollywood, you know, and just, and being messy and shady, I'm just like, this is not a good look for y'all. And you calling yourselves heirs to the throne, that's not royal behavior. But that's all I'm gonna say. Who wants to chime in?
I'll throw in maybe a little bit of a legal framework or point of view. For me, Heirs to the Throne was a legal maneuver more than it was an artistic endeavor. I think that was Max's moment where she got to some lawyers. She saw Cindy and Terry were moving the train forward. And they said, well, if you want to take that name, you better get out there and tour, and you go find you some replacements too. And we'll battle it out in 6 months or a year and see what happens. And she piggybacked on Dawn and said, Dawn, two of us fighting that name is better than just me. Why don't you get on board? So she brought Dawn on board. And so you had a little period there where some lawyers got to both sides, specifically Max and Dawn, and said, there's going to be a fight for this name. Build up your tour, build up your name, build up your branding so we can see what happens. And then they fought that fight and lost, clearly, and they should have lost. And then it was over. That's how I looked. I thought it was a mess creatively to begin with. I was not a fan of any of Max's efforts or Dawn's efforts at that time to try to compete with En Vogue. I thought it was all for one or nothing, just like I thought that way in 1998. Mm-hmm. So that was just my little legal theory. Of course, Matan, I have no proof. I can't show you any documents, but that's my feeling.
Yeah, I mean, at the end of the day, I think Maxine and Dawn, like, if you don't own the name, like, I used to work for a company that did concerts and marketing and promotions for concerts. Like, if we can't put the name En Vogue on marketing materials to promote the show, like, it's useless. Like, saying Heirs to the Throne, no one knows what that is. So, and even though, you know, people, En Vogue fans may know who Maxine is, and of course they know who Dawn is, but the general public is not going to be like, oh, Maxine Jones, let me go and, you know, rush to buy a ticket. You need the name recognition. So to me, it was kind of pointless to kind of do it. Unless they could have maybe managed to license or own the name, like maybe EV3 or EV4 or something that they could do that sounded more familiar with En Vogue, with the brand. Or they could do like the old members from the Supremes and did like the former ladies of former ladies of En Vogue. You know what I mean? And did their own little, you know, nostalgia, you know, Chitlin' Circuit act or whatever, but I don't know. To me, if you don't own the name, like, you're really stuck. Like, there's not a whole lot that you can do in terms of making a lot of money. Sure, you can do little gigs here paying, you know, a few thousand dollars, but you're not going to make any, you know, you're not going to make the significant money without the name.
Did anybody see any of the little gigs on the channel?
I saw what was on YouTube.
What did you think?
I mean, there was perform. What I saw, they were outside performing at some Chitlin' Festival. Or I mean, I don't know. I saw they were outside, and it was just you know, two members from En Vogue. I don't know who Shantae Usual is. I didn't see them as a trio. I saw Dawn and Maxine going, you know, doing their thing. But I think what I saw was Dawn and Maxine, you know, the last time they tried to come together, because they came together for Heirs to the Throne, and then they had beef. And then a few years later, they came back together. So that's what I remember seeing.
Yeah. A friend of mine, when they came back together, a friend of mine, same background for them, in Oakland at a club called Yoshi's. It's very popular. In the Bay Area. But that was just a short lived thing. When you were expecting En Vogue, you only get two. It's not exciting. You know, I will say that Dawn and Maxine do have leads on some of their most popular songs, but still,
you need the name. Like, yeah,
the same. You need the name. It matters. I know that you're a part of the name, right? But if you don't have the name, it doesn't.
And Champ, I think you and I briefly talked about this on Twitter. We were talking about the Pussycat Dolls, And like Nicole sings all yes. the leads, right? But she was never able to make it as a solo artist. People like the aesthetic of a group. You like to see the women in yeah. formation, doing the choreography, giving you the looks and all. Yes. Like that's the thing. Like you want to see the ladies get in formation, you know? So you can't get into formation with a duo.
Yeah. When I watched Heirs to the Throne, I watched, a few of their performances, like in a couple clubs, and I'm just kind of like, all you do is seeing them like rocking back and forth, snapping their fingers, very much karaoke, and I'm kind of like, this is not an En Vogue right. show. Like this is like a open mic or something. Like, and I'm like, we're used to seeing En Vogue, and granted, and then on top of that, En Vogue both iterations went through this period where they were wearing like jeans and tops on the stage.
Very
and
I'm Forever like, 21.
You don't have a name called it. You don't go, very much that. I'm like, you don't go from being this like iconic fashion idols to you're performing venues in denim jeans and these glittery. I'm like, it was just very cheap and low budget. And so I'm kind of like, it's just not a good look for the brand at all. So. Hang it up, well,
at that point, all of the versions of En Vogue, even Terry, Cindy, Rona, were not heavy record company backed. They're yeah. out there touring on their own investments and their own gigs directly with promoters. So they're not getting a budget to get glammed up. They're not getting and Dawn and Max have never had that since they've left.
But En Vogue, DT, so not jeans. I just can't, because you can go to Forever 21 and find you a cute little faux leather booty short that'll look a little bit more. I was like, they wear some Old Navy slim straights. I'm like, what is that? But let me stop. I love y'all. It was just,
well, it didn't work, obviously, and so then it became En Vogue to the Max. Dawn went her own way. She wanted everybody to know that she was still a solo artist. And I don't know if that was the iteration where she thought Maxine had colluded with the promoter to steal, you know, her, you know, fee and the fee of the band. But for whatever reasons, they parted ways. And then Maxine started En Vogue to the Max in early 2013. She began touring with Allison Carney and Maria Freeman. And, well, she called this lineup of En Vogue to the Max. And in March of 2013, the group performed at a Detroit Pistons halftime show. Okay, and then it looked like it was soon announced that Ellis and Heron sued Jones for use of the En Vogue name. A judge ruled that Heron and Ellis, as holders of the group's LLC, had exclusive rights to the group's name.
And in the meantime, she got in touch with Dawn. Mm-hmm. Or vice versa. But we believe she got in touch with Dawn, and then they started promoting, you know, putting out there in the public that they were uniting to do another En Vogue. They had a group called En Vogue, Heirs to the Throne, and they started booking shows. Well, that's when the trademark name became an issue, because it's okay. just not good business for the brand. To have two touring En Vogues in the market. And right. ultimately it was affecting us getting work, because the promoters were like, how do I know who I'm getting? And I don't right. want to hire any of y'all. And, you know, it was right. kind of like that. So then that became an issue. The name, oh. you know, the trademark name became an issue. And that's how it became an issue in the arbitration. And ultimately the arbitrator decided, and the federal court confirmed it, that we would
you guys
be the sole owners of that. We would retain the name.
Heron and Ellis also filed suit against Jones, demanding $1 million for unauthorized use of the name. Though the damages request was ultimately determined to be without merit, as Ellen and Harris could not demonstrate harm done to the company from Jones's use of the name. The group fell through, and Maxine created another group that went by the name En Vogue and consisted of members Maxine, of course, Hedda, and Jennifer. Nothing came of that group either. In 2014, Jones began recording her first solo album with producer DJ King Assassin, entitled To the Max. Jones released the lead single Didn't I on May 15th, 2014. Any thoughts on this? What did you think of this configuration?
Let me try to not get it convoluted. Okay, so can I just touch upon the legal fight there, where they're
yes,
duking it out over the name?
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
So yes. I watched that clip. Okay, I watched that clip of Cindy and Terry giving the interview to Access Hollywood on what the hell had just happened and why they had to fight. And what Cindy said was it was a dispute over management. There was interestingly a lot of things not said, but do you all understand how big a dispute over management is to a girl group or any group? If you have a manager doing things unfairly to two versus two or whatever, that's horrific. That's absolutely grounds to like stop working. It's like, we don't know the details. We never will. But a lot of things were not said in that interview, but it was sort of fashioned. And I think a lot of the En Vogue fans kind of take it and run with it that, you know, well, what the hell is wrong with you, Max and Dawn? Just get on the En Vogue, get back on the En Vogue train. Let's make this money. But by then, if you've got En Vogue with the same manager that they've had, they've now got huge loyalties to Terry and Cindy, who are, quote, on calling the shots. No, we're going to pick this gig, not that gig. No, I don't care if you got family obligations. You better be here by this date, not that day. We don't know what the details were that led Max to say, I cannot work with that manager. That is a huge reason to leave a group and live at your mom's house if you have to, for me. So the idea that that was somehow some bad thing, you know, of course, Maxine lost because ultimately Terry and Cindy had stayed on the En Vogue train from the beginning. So any court of law is going to grant them the name. Terry and if Dawn and Max were going to fight for the name, the time to do it was 1997 and 2001. Right. Dipping out for 10 years and coming back 10, 5, 7 years later and saying we own the name is never going to be successful. So that was never going to be a winning fight for Maxine or for Dawn. But I'm just making a point that it's a very legitimate thing for Maxine to say, I cannot be a part of a group where a manager does not have my best interest. So I'm going to fight as much as I can and try to restart this thing or my thing somewhere else. I just wanted to throw that in.
I respect that.
Yeah, and it cost her. Yeah, she didn't get rich, but I mean, it's a reasonable thing to do.
Yeah, to me, I wish that, I feel like this is a recurring theme, but I just wish that all the ladies would just see the bigger picture and learn how to compromise. And, you know, because at the end of the day, people want to see the originals. Like, I mean, it's no shade. That's what people want to see.
But what did they accomplish while they were together? See, that's my whole thing. It's like when you got together from 2009 to 2012 or however long it was, like what exactly was happening? So I get DT's point about the management, but at the same time, like, for instance, Cindy with Juice, like, you know, that wasn't En Vogue's manager who got her that role. That was probably, she had her own agent. So my whole thing is you always want to have value. And I think nowadays, you know, as we have access to the internet and things like that, it's all about having side hustles and multiple streams of income. So Maxine was the one who never, she, to my knowledge, she never did any solo music as the actual lead artist. She never starred in anything, never was on any plays during her tenure with En Vogue. Like, she never tried to be a songwriter that I know of. Maybe she was a black, I don't know. I just don't know. So it's like, how do you establish and give yourself value as an individual? That's, to me, will be the first thing that will happen in any situation where I'm in a group. I'm like, okay, well, I just need to make sure that, you know, because our lives are kind of intertwined, our income is kind of intertwined. I need to have my thing on the side, preferably in the music industry, maybe something outside of it, but in the music industry as well. So maybe I need to be a songwriter. Maybe I need to do songwriting camps and try to get a publishing deal. None of that happened. So then it just comes down to En Vogue, and it's going to be majority rules. That's how TMZ reported. They said that Cindy and Terry basically got the arbiter's decision because they were the majority. But then I read somewhere else that Maxine kind of lost because she violated the terms of their operating agreement by not showing up to shows that they'd already booked. So she violated the terms of the operating agreement. So then that's how she kind of lost her claim to the name. I don't know. And then I also heard that, like, she wanted her boyfriend to be her manager. I don't know if that's true. That was just like gossip I saw on the En Vogue Craze Facebook group. I don't know, but like DJ King Assassin, that name is very interesting to me. Producer DJ King Assassin. So I don't know what's going. Yeah, I don't know. But to me, it's just like, and this is like where I go back to from the beginning of our conversation, where it's like, well, this person doesn't have equity, this person, that person, this person. But it's like none of you really try to do anything to kind of make yourself indispensable. Like, it's and so even in groups where everybody isn't original, like if you're in the Rolling Stones and you're not Keith Richards or Mick Jagger, you could have been there longer than they have, but you didn't make yourself indispensable. There's this and I have to do my Gym of the Holograms reference just because I love that show, but there's this episode titled The Bands Break Up where you have the Misfits and the Holograms, both of their songwriters leave, Kimber and Stormer. And even though Jim is the lead singer and Pizzazz is the lead singer, like, they didn't know what to do without their writers. Like, I'm just like, they, like, to me, in, if you're in the entertainment industry, you have to be a creative. And it just seems like, you know, I just feel like they, Dawn and Max, didn't put in the work while they were in the group to pull kind of a stunt like that. And so just to anyone listening out there, like, make yourself invaluable, make yourself indispensable, have multiple streams of income, and... because that just it like if you are half of a group, like, I just don't see how you could, like, your name as an individual means nothing after, like, so many years in the business.
You have to look at it through the eyes of the 90s and the 2000s. This is what, 2022. I think a lot of artists and groups have been able to see the mistakes of people like En Vogue and TLC and Boyz II Men. And they're able to correct that and make multiple streams of income and do all of these things individually. At that time, in Vogue, like, when you were a group, you were a group. You did not operate individually unless you were done with the group. You know what I'm saying? So, I mean, to say, like, what would Dawn or Maxine do? Why their names don't mean much outside of the group? Nobody's checking for Cindy and Terry outside of the group either. Like, they're all four of them are in the same boat. Without the name En Vogue, none of them are really going to work. Yeah, Cindy has some acts.
But Cindy, they have the name, though. Cindy and Terry have the name, though.
Right, that's what I'm saying. So they're able to work with the name. So the fact that Maxine and Dawn are able to work as much, yeah, because they don't have the name. If they had equal ownership of the name, the same as Cindy and Terry, that would be, you know, a fair comparison, but they don't have the name. So it's kind of like, of course they're not going to work as much. Of course they're not going to have as much to offer because they don't own the name. But at the end of the day, if I'm a concert promoter and I'm looking, if I'm doing a 90s concert and I'm looking to book En Vogue, I don't give a damn if it's Cindy Dawn or if it's Rona and Jane Doe down the street. I need the name En Vogue so I can put on that flyer to market my concert. Like, it's the name that matters. No one is going for the sake of any individual member. None of them are above the name. So it's, you know what I'm saying? Like, if Cindy and Terry, let's, if it were reversed and Dawn and Maxine owned the name and Cindy and Terry didn't, Cindy and Terry wouldn't be working any more than Dawn and Maxine because they don't own the name. Like, not one of those members are above the name En Vogue, and that's just kind of where it is. I mean,
well, that's the philosophy I wish they had after Funky Divas. I mean, that's opening a can of worms, but that's the moment to me. And that's where people, I don't want to go out of the outline, but let me just say the second and bigger point that I think a lot of people had frustration with my letter, which was, I was quote unquote kind of hard on Terry, but I just still believe that in 1995, when En Vogue is at its height, mm-hmm. and the four of y'all are sitting now watching popcorn, watching, you know, how cute y'all look in these videos and celebrating the fact that y'all won, y'all sold 15 million albums. And y'all are sitting there like, we broke. We some broke bitches. Like, we got to do something. And y'all sitting there over popcorn and saying, we will not go into that damn studio until Tommy and Denny fix this. I don't know what they got to fix. I don't know what it's going to be. I don't know how to read a record contract, but we cannot go on. And y'all walk out of that room and say, okay, no more studio time. And then one of you go off and have a baby. One of you take a hiatus. One of you find a boyfriend. One of you go travel. And then suddenly y'all wake up a month later, and one of those girls is like, yeah, nah, I think I just don't agree with y'all. I'm in the studio about to do my solo gig, but hey, good luck. I just will never, that to me will never, that's, it practically broke my heart, if you want to know the truth, because Terry was my favorite, if you want to know the truth. Dawn broke out and became a Dawn fan. Terry was where I started. Terry was it for me. But when I learned the politics, and all of this is speculation, of turning your back on a group when it was at the height of his negotiating power. And I do use the word turning your back because she could have said, let's at least give it a shot. I'm not going to go in the studio and let's try to get 8 pennies a record. Let's try to get 16 pennies, something. But to just fall flat and not do anything, I believe in my heart, the group never recovered from that. That's just my belief. And they went in their separate ways. And yes, Terry and Cindy can still tour now and make some money. And Dawn's living with her mom, whatever, however you want to frame what it looks like today. That is the moment to me that changed the destiny of En Vogue.
I'm thinking of the part where during the lawsuit between Cindy and Terry and Maxine and Dawn, like how they tried to sue Maxine for $1 million, you know, for unauthorized use of the name. And obviously it says that the request was denied and didn't have any merit. But I just feel like that, in my personal opinion, I'm like, the damage is already done and you're trying to get me to pay you $1 million? You know, I just feel like that is a level of petty that I would never understand.
That's a legal thing that the lawyer probably did.
Yeah, and whoever, and whatever lawyer, but at the end of the day, you pay that lawyer to do what, and they come to get
right. But they're going to tell you, oh no, let's put the pressure on this one. They say,
hold on.
Okay.
I know, hold on. But hold on. What I'm saying is, they hire a lawyer, and the lawyer obviously gives you all these legal options of what is possible. So for you to say, let's do this, and they file a motion of $1 million, if I'm Maxine, I'm
you
like,
know I'm broke, girl.
That's the like, point.
That's how you feel. You know what I mean? But what I'm saying, I just feel like that's, you already got the name.
No, they didn't already have the name. You didn't read, no, they didn't already have the name. They were in arbitration.
It's not on the wound. And so for me, I feel like it makes me look at Terry with a side eye. So I'm like, okay, you do this little lawsuit, you know, and then I look back and I'm like, well, so you decided to go behind our back and, you know, turn our third album into your solo album that did not do well, that was not critically acclaimed. You know what I mean? Matan talks about how he went to the CD signing and nobody did. Her perfume signing, but that's still a part of her brand of being a solo artist. No one can buy your perfume. So I just feel like we will never know. Everything is speculation. Everything is assumption. We will never know what really went down, behind the scenes. But we all said it before. I feel like the reason why they haven't done any reality TV, the way they want to is because there's gonna be a time where they're gonna have to spill the beans, and the beans being spilled is not gonna put them in a good light, because it's gonna reveal some petty stuff that happened 10, 20, 15 years ago, you know? So I feel like no one is above reproach, and I feel like no one is like innocent, in my opinion. But it does make me look at Terry like, dang, like, you know, you really did, you know, do kind of that. And it's like, and then Dawn also has a talking point where she says, you know, Sylvia Rohn's method was divide and conquer. You know, I'm going to divide the ladies up and I'm going to talk to you. So I could speculate Sylvia, you know, having a meeting with Terry by herself saying, well, girl, you know, Cindy pregnant and, you know, Dawn is over here. So I was like, well, what are you going to do? You know, I mean, we can give you a solo deal. I can give you an advance so you can like not lose your car, or you can pay your water bill, girl. You know, I could see that happening. And then Terry being young and impressionable, she's like, okay, well, let's do it. You know, and I feel that the lack of success in her solo album is the karma for that decision. But this is just speculation.
Well, let me say this real quick.
This is just that. I don't know for sure.
Let me say this real quick. Is everyone, you guys are familiar with the City Girls, right?
Unfortunately, yes. Okay. Yes.
So, but no, this is a great example because it's 2022. This is a female group that's currently out there. And one of the members from the City Girls has her own podcast called Carisha Please. On the Revolt Network. And one of the things I thought was very interesting was that They are a two-person group, and they were talking about how, as a group, they've had people inside their own camps, inside their own record labels, inside their own management team that have tried to divide them, that have tried to be like, well, she doing this, so you need to go do that, and da da da. We need to go ahead and, you know, y'all gonna work on this album, but now we need to push y'all to do solo albums. And they were talking about how people within their own team have been trying to divide them. And because of their relationship, they're like, hell no, I'm not doing this. I'm not doing anything music related without the other, because we have that bond. We have that situation, and I can't do this without her. And I think that is just really important. And I wish more groups had that type of mentality, because unfortunately, what does happen is there is a divide and conquer mentality. People within your same label, within your same management company are going to try to break you up to get whatever piece of the pie that they feel like they can get out of the situation. And unfortunately, I think En Vogue is just one of those groups that fell for it early on. And I'm glad that, you know, groups have learned from these mistakes, because nothing is bigger than that brand. Nothing is bigger than that name that you're starting with. And you're going to have people like Sylvia Roan. You're going to have people who are trying to, okay, you do a solo album. Like that was, if you read the nine laws of power, like division is your best way to get your hold on a situation. And that's what Sylvia Roan did. So when Terry took that record deal, she's like, you know, I know we all broke, but I got this option, so I'm going to go take it. Like, the group never recovered from that. Like, there is...
They did. They had their biggest hit after that. Then you had the person who has all the issues, who had an issue with Maxine.
Yeah, they got a big hit. But what happened after their biggest hit? They had the biggest hit of their career. And what happened?
That's what happened. She's the one. So I don't see how people try to turn it around. And be like,
of course she left, because Sylvia Roan offered her a record deal and then tried to take it back. Like, of course she left.
No, she didn't try to take it back. It was delayed. We don't know why it was delayed. Just like, what did they say? Your blessing is not
Sylvia used that record. Sylvia used that record deal to try and control her. She used that record deal to try and control her, to get her to do what she wanted. That is literally divide and conquer.
They have their biggest hit, but the damage was already done.
No, it wasn't already done. It was not already done. You had this one tempestuous person who everything after that was just
absolutely
a downward spiral. Everything that she did is that one individual. Because the other three, Cindy, Maxine, why did they want to stick around then if everything was so
repetitive? Because some people are weak-minded. Cindy had a man who already had an income. So Cindy's life wasn't going
to
change.
She's weak-minded because she was smart enough to marry a man with an income and down.
That's what you try to imply
that they're weak-minded.
Everybody operates from the point that's going to work best for them. So at the end of
weak-minded?
No, it's not weak-minded, but if you are working from a standpoint of, I'm looking out for myself. I got a man. He is a baseball player. He got a contract. He got millions coming in. So my main concern is not this group. My main concern is not how many records we're going to, you know, how much money we're making per record. My life is good. I'm comfortable.
Okay, then Maxine. What about Maxine? Is she weak-minded?
She might have been. Happy to be in a group. That's the thing. Like, how many stories have we heard of people who are like, yeah, I know I signed a record deal and I had a hit record, but I was still living in the projects. But yet I'm still on tour. I got records on the radio, but I'm still poor. Like, that is literally, people look at fame and they just roll with it. So, I mean,
she wasn't that, because we saw when those bankruptcy filings came out and she had to list her assets. She had like two properties. One was an income property. So like, she might not have been mega rich, but like, that's what I'm saying. You did two albums. Like, it's like some groups have to do multiple albums so they start making money and touring, even the big ones. That's just the nature of the industry. So you're not a star, you're not a legend with just two albums. They decided to take a break after their biggest album instead of moving forward, maybe for personal reasons or whatever, but to try to turn that around and be like, because Terry did this, Dawn went on this downward spiral, then everything, she complained about their contract, but then signed, according to her, the same type of contract with Lucy Pearl.
I'm not critical of anything after. Like, Dawn's made mistakes. Dawn's been reckless with her words. Dawn's made record industry mistakes, created enemy. We can talk all day about Dawn starting from January 1st, 1997. I want someone who's anti-Dawn to give me some commentary on Terry in 94, 95. Everyone just jumped, said, well, that didn't matter. So back to 97, right. When Dawn became, can I right. actually get a response to you from you, Matan, as of to course. What your honest opinion was? If you were in Terry's shoes, sitting on that couch eating popcorn with your friends, like I sort of set the scene hypothetically, are you at all critical or do you have any comment on Terry's decision to not negotiate, to agree to renegotiate two pennies a record with her girls and say, sorry, I don't agree. You all negotiate as three. I'm going to go on in here with Denny and do this album. Do you have any commentary on that?
That's and record this album.
Stop trying to make it all juicy, JP. You added extras to it. Let me respond. I feel like we're going to go over this in submitted letter, so I just have to hold my tongue then, but I will say this. One, I don't believe the two pennies thing, but I'll just say that that's true. Like I said in the previous episode, they did renegotiate their contract. They were signed to a production deal with Too Tough Enough. That contract was null and void because someone quit. That's the way Don explained it. So they were able to negotiate directly with the label. So they were renegotiating their contract. Don has even said that when she got her solo rights taken out of the contract, that was it. It was nothing else. So they were renegotiating the contract. She was renegotiating with them as a group, but she exercised her solo rights just like Dawn tried to exercise her solo rights a few months or a few weeks. I don't even know how long, what the process was for her record, because I know she went in the studio and did songs, and that writer that she did songs with, I haven't heard the song that she did songs with that writer, but I've heard a sampler from that artist, Monet, and it was tired and through. So when Sylvia heard that, she was probably like, oh no, Terry's already didn't do well. Dawn is bringing me a bunch of, boring stuff.
See, for me, you're moving back into the Dawn story.
Right, well, I'm just saying, no,
come on, DT. Get them together.
Okay.
See, Matan is not used to having more than one person support Dawn and holding Terry accountable. So now Matan is shivering. Come on, DT.
Y'all are trying to make it seem like it was a huge point of contention for her to do this solo record, but the only person saying that is Dawn. So has Maxine or Cindy spoken about it being this huge point of contention of her doing a solo record?
When I got one person putting it on the table and nobody taking it off the table, I got to go with the person that put it on the table. I'd like to get Terry, Maxine, and Cindy give me something to shut me up.
Period.
Oh, okay, so that means you believe that Maxine colluded with the promoter to steal Dawn's portion of the funds because Maxine didn't put it on the tape because Maxine never posed rebuttal. That means it's true.
Nope.
By that logic, you have to, because you said she didn't put anything on the table, so you're going to believe the person who did put it on the table. So you believe that then?
Without a rebuttal, sure, but That rule applies, that's my general rule of life. If someone has an allegation or a comment or opinion and it attacks someone else's character or choice and that person doesn't step up for themselves and say that is wrong, until I hear otherwise and they bring it with some decent facts, I don't have a reason to dispute them. So I'm not saying that Dawn didn't maybe exaggerate, or maybe there's some details she left out, or Maxine may have a great excuse, but I haven't heard it. So back to 95, you were saying?
So yeah, back to 95, I'm saying the only person, that's your philosophy, and that seems to kind of be, isn't it like the judicial system is the person making accusation has the burden of proof and is innocent until proven guilty. I've never seen her show a contract. I don't believe in the two pennies because there was one interview where she mentioned points, and that's the only time she mentioned points. She said that En Vogue had the same amount of points as Denny and Tommy, and that the reason that Denny and Tommy didn't really care about like the way the contracts were was because they were only spilling it two ways. I don't believe executive producers and producers were only getting four pennies a record. I believe they were getting points, and the points is probably multiplied by a certain amount of something else, just like how TLC did it. So I already don't believe that. But then too, like I said, I don't think it was a huge point of contention. I think that Maxine would not have been a background vocalist on that record if it was such a huge point of contention. I believe that is what somebody is trying to say to cover face for her bad decisions that just spiraled out of control. That's what I think. I do not think it's a huge deal to have a member doing a solo record. It's it's never that deep. I mean, so many groups have done it. I don't think it's a big deal. If you're a drummer, there's drummers like Slash when he was doing all that stuff with all these other artists. Like, that's what you can do when your group is not, is off and not touring. You make money doing what you did in the group. If you're a guitarist, you're going to play guitar for some other people. You might join a super group. You might do this, that, and third. You might do a solo record. It's not a big deal. It's only a big deal to like someone who's just super sensitive and emotional and wants to use that as a scapegoat for bad decisions that that person made. That's how I feel about 1995.
But hold on, I gotta say this. Maxine doing backgrounds for Terry's solo album, that's like, at the end of the day, they're the same producers that produce majority of their work. So doing background vocals, like, that is not a commitment. Like, that is not a situation where it's like, oh, Terry, I support you, so I'm gonna do background. They could have told Maxine anything. They could have said, girl, we need you to lay these bottom notes down so that, you know, this is a record we're thinking about doing a demo, you know, for potential for the next EV record. So, you know, lay these bottom vocals down. Like,
but y'all are acting like it's a big act of war to even go in the studio, so you can't have it both ways.
But no, I mean, doing the demo and doing some backgrounds is not that deep. Let me just say this. At the end of the day, if we are in a group, we, like, let's say it's four of us. It's me, Matan, Champ, and Josh. We are four people in a group. And if I say, you know, this has been fun, y'all, but I got an opportunity to go and do this other podcast about En Vogue that's picked up by Spotify, and I'm gonna go do my thing and I'm gonna leave y'all. You can't tell me you're not gonna feel a way that
I feel a way.
Exactly. That's what I'm saying.
Because the added layer you said Spotify is that we don't use Spotify. so I would be like, oh, so you going to the conference. Right,
but even I'm just saying, like, whatever. I'm moving on. I'm gonna go and pack my bags. I'm going over here. You can't tell me you wouldn't feel away. It doesn't mean that we're not gonna be cool. It doesn't mean we're not gonna be cordial, but I'm going over here to do something else. It doesn't mean you're gonna start a riot. It doesn't mean that we're gonna throw hands, but you still feel a way. You know what I'm saying? Like, there's no way that you can reasonably tell me that Terry taking that solo deal did not make the other two or three ladies feel some type of way. And my point is, like, once you feel a way, once the trust has been broken, once there's been a fracture, you can try to move on, but it's not going to be the same. Like, I can break my leg today and I can fracture my bone, and I can put it in a cast or whatever. It's not going to be the same. It's just not going to be the same situation. Like, you're always going to have that fracture there. There's always going to be that, you know what I'm saying, that crack. And to me, I think Terry taking that solo deal without the rest of them knowing, couple that with the fact that they had negotiating power, when they had the ability, Funky Divas was one of the biggest records of that era. They had the ability and the negotiating power to go somewhere else and really make more money. Like, you can't tell me that the other ladies are not going to feel a way. Like, that's just human nature. And
has anyone seen any of these contracts?
Of course not. Come on. This is all conjecture. Like, okay. Come on. Let's be real. None of us have seen contracts. This is all just conversation and conjecture and speculation at this point. But,
okay.
But what I'm saying is, like, it's not unreasonable for the other people to feel a way, like, you know, like, we are okay with you. We still love you. You did what you felt like you needed to do, but we still love you. But yeah, there's something in the back of my mind that is going to feel a way. This next letter comes from Justice Jackson, and Justice Jackson says, everybody a part of us, Justice here. First off, I want to say I'm loving the topics this season and the new segments. We're getting deep and juicy and I love it. But, and I hate to cut the formalities short, and I have to get right to it because, baby, this episode had me on fire. My letter is not going to take up a whole episode, I promise. This is more of a... that was shade to DT. But this is more of a response to Mr. DT than you guys. But I got a lot to say. But I got to say that I don't appreciate the fact of how you call yourself an En Vogue fan and yet don't respect all the members. I know everyone has their fave and all, but the slander to Rona was, I feel very out of pocket. Everyone touched on this perfectly, but I just want to reiterate the fact that Rona is here and has been here and is staying, well, until she disagrees. But anyway, she's staying here and her contributions to the group should be respected and not minimized, because Cindy and Terry could honestly have sat down somewhere years ago and been retired. She's keeping the brand alive and should be respected along with the other members of this group. So DT, so since this one was directed at you and your letter, what do you have to say?
Appreciate everything the person wrote. They have some excellent points. I will concede, like I did at the beginning of the show, my passion for En Vogue was the original four. My belief is that everything past the original four has been an attempt at recapturing something that can never be captured. I believe that Rona is, as an individual, as talented as they come. She put out a solo record. I will be in line buying it. Now, in terms of respecting her as a part of En Vogue, I respect her as keeping the brand going, like you said. I respect her as being talented, but she does not at all come close to bringing me the passion and the fandom that I had for the original four. So I hope that's not disrespectful to her or her fans. But to me, I don't know. You know, the closing point I'll make is this. If she's so valuable to all of the current En Vogue fans, why don't y'all write a letter to Cindy and Terry and tell them to break her off some in equity? If you all have the passion that shut up people who diss Rona, then direct that passion to somebody that's going to put some change in her pocket and give her some lifetime security, which is Terry and Cindy. Or otherwise, she's just that great loyal employee that's going to work her butt off. And one day, i.e. Spinderella or all these
come
other
on,
people,
come on,
stay in that arrangement and wake up one day and say, why? That's what she is.
Period.
That's the same
period.
Thing the drummer feels when they go on the road with En Vogue. That's the same way the roadie feels. This is a check and a job for an assignment. This is not what I own. That's a big, huge difference. Now, when she becomes an owner of En Vogue, bring me back on the show so I can say you were wrong. They loved her. She really did have equity. Like, I'm happy to do that. But right now, I just think that's what Rona is, an excellent fill-in. She's a supreme fill. She's Cindy Birdsong.
Cindy Birdsong. She's Michelle Williams.
When you look in the dictionary in 100 years and they talk about great girl groups and they have this glamorous picture of this group known as En Vogue, it's going to be Terry, Dawn, Cindy, and Maxine. It ain't going to be Rona.
This is
all I can say. I don't say that to disrespect her. I say that to show my appreciation for what was, to me, the greatest group that ever existed from the start.
Matan, you want to continue the letter?
Yeah, I'm going to. Justice continues, which brings me to my next point. I think it's really unfair how you loaded up the chopper and just let it rain on Terry as if she single-handedly stopped the group in their tracks like she was Nicole from the Pussycat Dolls or something. It's unfair to throw the blame solely on her, especially considering the fact that Dawn claimed that she, Dawn, didn't want to go solo. Dawn used Terry's solo project as a point of contention, yes, she did, to do her own solo project. Mr. DT, you need to put some respect on Terry and Rona's name, sir. Ooh, DT, he's talking to you.
To me, all the women bear some responsibility at some point, a decision they could have made, a conversation they could have had to keep things going. But to me, the domino effect started with Terry's, not her decision to decide to go solo. I never said I had a problem with that. I had a problem with her decision to not renegotiate at the snapshot moment when it mattered the most. That's what I have a problem with.
But what do you mean? Can I ask you what you mean by not renegotiating? Because they were in renegotiation. So what do you mean by not renegotiating?
You say the girls did go on to renegotiate and that's why we had an EV4. The girls went on and recorded EV3 without negotiations being finalized. So they're in the studio being told, we'll work it out. Yeah, y'all mad about two pennies, but go on and get in front of the mics. We'll send it to the lawyers later and we'll get this stuff inked before the album comes out. Then they get to this infamous meeting where Dawn is comes late, where the lawyers are there and a contract is put in front of them to renegotiate. Now you think that contract was just that's my understanding. I could be wrong, but
that's my understanding too.
The negotiations, you keep saying they were negotiated and but maybe not even to anybody's satisfaction. They may have just a new deal was signed, is all I know. A renegotiation that all the women were satisfied with certainly didn't happen. I don't think it happened. Maxine later said that, no, yeah, we signed that contract the day you got kicked out, Dawn, but I didn't like it then, and I still don't like it. Like, Maxine backed her later and said it was a bullshit renegotiation that she still wasn't happy with. Now, I don't know how much better it was in the original contract, but it was some mess by Dawn and Maxine's comments later on. Now, I don't know the specifics beyond that, but they didn't have this perfect, great, worked out contract when Masterpiece Theater was released. That's always been my understanding.
No. Okay. So the contract, when we talk about the infamous meeting, that was the contract to promote the record. It wasn't a record contract. It was a commitment to promote EV3 for 2 years. And Dawn didn't want to promote the record for 2 years because she had a solo project. Isn't that funny? She had a solo project, so she didn't want to commit to promoting the EV record, EV3, for 2 years. And still, I don't know how she ended up. It was a separate meeting where she had to have signed her rights away. So I don't know what she had going on at that point. But no, they renegotiated. They were in renegotiation. There were renegotiations when Cindy was pregnant, when Maxine was pregnant. They renegotiated. Yeah, that contract was something different. That was to promote EV3. And maybe the impetus behind Sylvia wanting a 2-year commitment was because she knew that Dawn probably was ready to jump ship because she had a solo record with Aftermath and Dr. Dre.
The little bit of work I did years ago, I never saw a scenario where you had just a separate standalone promotion contract that didn't pair up with the overall contract with your label. So to me, if you're working on a promo contract, then you still got a overarching contract about rights, royalty, distribution, benefit, budget, all of that. It's not just going to be a side. And now I'm not saying that didn't happen. I'm just saying that that's not how I've ever seen contracts negotiated, where you got a bullshit 2 cents a record deal that you want to get out of, but you got this parceled out promo deal about one album. We're going to wear this outfit. We're going to get paid $1 a tour or whatever those terms were. So you could be right, Matan. I'm not disputing it, but I've always understood in my reviews of social media to know that contract that they were dealing with the day someone, quote, put something in Dawn's face and told her to sign it. She didn't sign it because it was some mess, just like the prior deals. And so she didn't sign it. Now, later, after she said, I'm done, some lawyers put some papers in front of her a month or 6 months later and said, look, if you're really done with us, take this $5,000 and be gone. That might have been what happened to her. All of this speculation. But I'm looking at the facts that went down maybe a little differently than you are. And I could be wrong. I could be half right. I could be half wrong. But that's always been my understanding.
What she said is that she went. Well, anyway. Okay. Well, I guess, you know, if there's clips or anything of Dawn talking about.
And Dawn said meeting, she agreed to promote the EP3 album, though. That's the other thing. Like, she literally there's some.
She agreed to record it.
She said she agreed to promote it.
For how long?
But I don't know how long, but En Vogue didn't even promote the album for 2 years.
Right, that's the whole thing. That's why the whole thing, after her not wanting to commit for 2 years, it just was pointless for all that to happen because Sylvia wanted her to, you know, commit to the group. Like, you can listen to any.
But if Sylvia signed away her solo rights, what would be the. Like, why would you sign away her solo rights if you were not trying to let her go solo?
Because there was a term in the original contract that placed a premium on solo rights, probably. So Sylvia Rome could have been like, wait a minute. I got to do this, 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 and this under the terms of this original deal for every solo. Think about all the stuff she had to do with Terry's album that was an expense. She's like, let somebody else handle that solo responsibility. The money is with En Vogue. I believe at that moment in time, she probably felt it wasn't worth the investment anymore. But I'm obligated to do it under this contract. So you know what, Dawn? You're right. We would be breaching a contract by not letting you go solo. So here, we release you from your solo rights. We won't charge you for the studio time. The advances you took for that solo, you can keep them, girl. But be on your way. Now report at 9 o'clock for this 2 cents a record deal so we can get this En Vogue train going. That's what I believe Sylvia Rome did, which was smart because Dawn was feeling herself. I'm about to blow up anyway, whether it's with Sylvia Rome or Dr. Dre. I'm sure she had gotten to that point. So she was happy to go shop around to find a bigger, greater deal. She believed in herself. But that's just, again, like you said, I don't have a single document to put in front of you. I don't have any tapes of conversations back then, but that's just my speculation.
Okay, well, now that we have that clarified, let's get back into Justice's letter. He continues, I do agree with Josh on the point where, with the group not working at that time, Terry felt like, well, not that she had to do the solo project, but had to do the solo project to keep income coming in. I honestly believe there was a bigger issue behind the scenes, which honestly caused the hiatus to begin with. Not sure if you guys have seen it, but when the OG4 reunited back in 08 through 09, there was a trailer being shopped around for a reality show documenting their reunion and comeback, and Terry states there was supposed to be a third EV album. I'm going out on a limb to assume it was supposed to be an immediate follow-up to Funky Divas, and she said that didn't happen and it became her solo album. Then she says, well, I had bills to pay, and Dawn retorts saying, we all had bills to pay. We should have stuck together, etc. I'm paraphrasing here. I believe the trailer is still on YouTube.
He continues to say, also, my aunt is a big En Vogue fan. I remember her saying there were rumors going around that time about En Vogue being blackballed. Not sure how entirely true that is, but I am inclined to believe that to an extent, based on that whole debacle with Luther Vandross. I'm not sure how much power he would have had back then to get them blackballed, but it's one of those things that makes you go, Considering how things fell, and even when the ladies returned in 96 on the set of Don't Let Go, Cindy mentioned how they never planned to be away as long as they were at the time. So I do believe Terry should not have done a full solo project. The timing wasn't right, and the ladies were only two albums in and off such a successful era like Funky Divas. And as mentioned, it was such a departure from the Evie sound. It wasn't a good move at the time. I feel like maybe they should have just did a few solo spots, guest appearances on soundtracks or duets with other artists, sung a few rap hooks, etc. It would have been like the perfect balance of getting herself out there as a solo act while at the same time keeping En Vogue visible and the brand intact. I do agree with that. It wasn't the right time for a solo project, especially when En Vogue is at their height. Like, why would you deviate from this formula that is working so well and now has this crossover appeal to build another brand from the ground up, which is Terry Ellis.
I think it was the right time. It wasn't the right music.
That too. I mean, because granted, her solo endeavor, it could have been successful, but the music didn't. It wasn't palatable. No shade to Tommy and Denny, but it just wasn't. It didn't resonate, you know. And guest appearances for Terry, that does sound, you know, because at the time, you know, all the black movies were having all these soundtracks that were blowing up. So Terry having a song on like a movie soundtrack, a rom-com, or whatever, that makes sense, you know. Maybe it could have happened, but I guess we'll never know.
So last thing, I do want to chime in on the question that JP asked about En Vogue replacing Dawn straight out of the gate and if things would have turned out differently for the ladies. I want to say yes, and that should have been the plan of action as soon as Dawn left. Reason being, part of En Vogue's appeal was the fact that they were a quartet, from how they looked as a four-piece down to how they sound with their harmonies. To be honest, it was by design for them to be a quartet, considering they all do the lead and background vocals, unlike with some groups where you may have the lead singer who does the lead and background vocals themselves, with the other members sprinkled in at some parts. That wasn't the case for EV. I believe had they replaced Dawn right then, There would have been some controversy, yes, but I think the adjustment would not have been so rough for fans and the general public because they would have still been a quartet. And let's say Rona joined then, she would have had the chance to grow on people. And I agree 100%. So.
Sidebar, this may sound random, but I think Tisha Campbell, didn't we talk about Tisha Campbell one episode? Justice.
Yes.
Now I was rocking with you for most of this letter, but no. But anyway, you're saying that you think Tisha Campbell would have been the perfect replacement for Dawn. Watch that clip of En Vogue on Happily Ever After where they play the Barbies and Tisha is the tin soldier. She sounds crazy similar to Dawn, but does she look crazy? Like, she wouldn't fit. But anyway, if you were to close your eyes and if we were to close our eyes maybe and listen to the song, you would think it's just En Vogue's track with all OG members. But when we opened our eyes, what would happen? Okay, anyway, enough of babbling. I just wanted to chime in on the discussion. Great episode, you guys. Again, keep up the good work. Cannot wait for the next episode. P.S. Funky Mellow Christmas is trash and corny. I agree. Sorry, you guys, but that needs to stay in Japan where it was left at Vi. Yes, I agree. Now, okay, you brought me back. Yes, that record was, it was just horrible.
Thank you, Justice. We always love you when you write in. I do not agree on Tisha Campbell.
And I love Tisha Campbell, but Tisha Campbell, Tashina Arnold, no, they wouldn't fit.
I love Tisha, by the way. Like, I think I loved her in School Days. That performance is iconic. Like, even when her and Tashina were a duo group, I love their single. Tisha can sing, but it just wouldn't have. I think that putting Tisha in Vogue, I'm just exploring it, she would have had to combat being Gina. In her career, most of it has been her being the height of her career is her being like this goofy girlfriend, light skin, I just don't feel like it would have fit with the sultry look of En Vogue. You know what I mean? But I love Tisha Campbell though.
It didn't happen, but to speculate, I don't know. I would prefer, like I said, totally flip it. Get a man who plays an instrument in the group, totally flip it on his hair. But y'all wasn't feeling that.
Oh, thank you. We're going to go on to our rare track section. How Deep Is Your Love is a cover from the 1977 Bee Gees classic. It was recorded by Cindy and Terry back in 2003 between the period of Amanda Cole leaving the group and Rona joining. The track is a part of the Church Songs of Soul, the Inspiration album. Cindy and Terry performed it once on an episode of Extra. Did you guys have any thoughts on the song?
I loved it.
I think it sounds good. I don't think that they added anything to the track, but they sound good. It's pretty smooth, but it's nothing like a groundbreaking. Like, even when I watched the audio on YouTube, a lot of the comments were just like, oh my god, it's breathtaking. It's so, I'm like, it wasn't anything special. And then of course, like, even hearing PJ Morton's version with Yebba Smith recently, I don't think that it's memorable in that regard. You know the door to my very soul. You're the light in my deepest, darkest hour. You're my savior when I fall. But I love the fact that En Vogue continues to pay homage to all the groups, from back in the day, the 60s, 70s, 80s. I love that they continue to pay homage to those people.
Yeah, I enjoyed the track. I loved it. I actually bought that CD when it came out, and there was a lot of artists on there. I believe Chaka Khan, Stephanie Mills, They're, I think, Denise Graves. There's just a lot of different, legendary singers on that record. Of course, I bought it because, you know, Cindy and Terry had the How Deep Is Your Love track on it. And then I think it had these really cute pictures of, like, a lot of the women as little girls. And there was a picture of who, well, definitely I could tell who Cindy was. And there was a little young lady who I suspect to be Terry because it looked like she was in the country and she had these long pigtails. I was like, that's Terry. And I'm usually spot on. So I'm pretty sure that was her. But I loved it. It was a very subtle vocal from both of them. You know, the Bee Gees, I mean, when you hear a Bee Gees record, even if it's not the Bee Gees, even if it's one of the Gibb brothers, like, there's a particular sound that they have. So no one is ever going to be able to replicate that. So I'm happy they tried to do something different by just making it a little bit more soulful, but still subdued. And then I liked the addition of the gospel choir. So I liked it. I always wanted to see that performance, and I was never able to. So hopefully one day it surfaces on the, you know, the craze. Just actually regarding that, there's an announcement. So we know that the content on our YouTube page for the last year or so has primarily been podcast episodes, but we want to assure our listeners that the Crazes YouTube channel will return to its former state with En Vogue performances, interviews, and rare footage. I'm so excited. We have the content, so to speak, hypothetically say, you know, we just need to physically get our hands on it so it can be uploaded and shared with all of you. So stay tuned. We're excited. Okay, and these are just some of the parting rules that we want to give to you. Stream Part of Us on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Amazon Music, YouTube, and most other podcasting apps. For more En Vogue related content, find us on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram at En Vogue Craze, Twitter at Part of Us Fancast. Comments, ideas for the show, questions, write them down and send them to us in an email to partofusevf@gmail.com. If you like what you hear, please rate and review our podcast. Thank you so much to the co-host. Thank you so much to our guest, Mr. DT, and always, yes, Josh. Like, I just hate anytime, like, you know, I have to do an episode without you because you're like the Don Cornelius Air Bradley. But shout out to you and shout out to all the listeners. And I think that's it, right? Let's wrap it up.
Can I just tell you all, thank you so much for having me. This is my favorite podcast. Each of you are, I just love hearing every word, all of it. I agree to disagree on things, but I still learn. And you all have such a wonderful podcast here. So I hope you guys keep this going forever. And then I can, one day you guys will remember me when you're like famous.
Ah, thank you so much. Those are the closing words. Thank you.
For sure. You've really added a dynamic to the podcast we didn't have, especially with your background. So thank you for being here.
Yeah, you and JP trying to gang up on me. JP thought he was going to give me this time. No.
Thank y'all for listening. We'll see you next time.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
This episode of Part of Us at En Vogue Fancast was researched, written, produced, and edited by Matthew at Culture Inject Productions. The intro and outro music was produced by Wolves and Vincent Tone. We're more than just a podcast. We're a fan community. You can keep up to date on En Vogue and chat with other fans by visiting En Vogue Craze on Facebook. You can also follow us on YouTube and Instagram at En Vogue Craze and Twitter at Part of Us Fancast. Part of Us and En Vogue Fancast is not endorsed by En Vogue, E1 Music, or En Vogue Records, and is intended for entertainment and educational purposes only. En Vogue and its names, images, and audio clips are registered trademarks and or copyrights of their respective copyright holders.
The only person I could have seen would have been Dee Reed from Jade. That
or Deborah Cox.
No, thank you. Dee Reed from Jade.
Deborah Cox would have been amazing.
No, she's a solo artist. Her voice is not a group voice. She's a solo artist.
I mean, technically they're all solo artists.
No, but, I wouldn't say that either.
But
I would say,
you know what?
Deborah Cox that would be like Whitney Houston being in a group. No, you don't do that.
I'll be here for
no, thank you. That would be no point. It would be Whitney and the background singers. No, you don't do that.